conversation to see what,
yeah, but I think
what you mean by this.
I think it's kind of a double standard, though, how you sit there and say that, well, you don't understand this because you're not a scientist. You haven't studied it like
I have. When have I said this? When did I say it one time that you are not a scientist?
But, Dragna, that's your attitude because that's what you said.
That's my attitude? I say, okay, there's a lot of things that you don't study, Vekel. And I said, you know what? I can offer to help you. And then you don't, you're not interested in help. Well, no, don't tell me what my attitude is, Vekel, because I've offered this. I have offered to help you and G-Man and Arcane on multiple occasions, private and in public.
But Dragna, that was your attitude.
Spat in my face. So I don't. So when I have an attitude, because someone, hold on, let me finish.
You're smarter than admin, okay? And we're not taking that away from you. We, you know, brother, I appreciate that you studied this issue way more than most people in this hangout. But again, my challenge to everyone here is that how do we know, according to the way it was written by the original author, that the dust of the earth is contrary to what you're proposing?
Okay, and I'm fine, and that is very acceptable. It could mean something different. Is that what you were getting at?
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
So, and all I've been trying to do this entire time is find out what that different substance is.
Okay, and like I said, no one knows.
Okay, we can know. We actually can know. We have geological history of the Earth.
No. I'm talking about what the Bible meant when it says dust of the Earth.
What the Bible meant. Okay, so. Does the Bible speak of another substance that is not the Earth's crust?
No, it does not.
Okay, so how are you drawing this conclusion that there was something else when the Bible doesn't speak of something else?
That you're saying that there's an error just because it uses the term dust of the earth. If you don't speak Hebrew, you don't write or understand it, how do you know what exactly dust of the earth actually meant then?
Because we'll have a reference. Just like you said, if it's referring to something else, then we can call that reference based on the information that it gives us. Can we not?
So do you know what it's meant when Moses or whoever wrote Genesis, what did he mean when he said dust of the earth? What does that mean?
That means what you have underneath your feet walking, that material.
Okay. But you don't accept the fact that because this is a Hebrew, this is a different language, that it could be using it as an idiom of some sort.
And that's fine.
Actual.
If it's referring to something that's not actual dirt, then I am perfectly fine with that. I would just like it defined.
Well, the Bible doesn't have that obligation.
If it doesn't say it, then how are you drawing that conclusion?
Okay, the only conclusion I'm drawing, you've heard me say, was agree with what the Bible says, that the dust of the ground, that's it.
The dust of the ground. Okay, and so if it doesn't indicate that it means something different than what we are commonly referring to as the dirt, how are you posing this opposition against what I'm saying?
But not on surface level. I'm just simply saying that it's using very, very simple language to say what man came from.
And that's fine. And it can use simple language. So from that simple language, where is the inference in Hebrew that you're positing that it is talking about something different?
No, that's my challenge to you, because you're the one proposing an argument saying that it's contrary to what science proposes. And I'm going to say, how is so when it's using very almost ambiguous language here that
it's not, dust is not ambiguous. Dust of the earth is not ambiguous. If you pick up dirt and you've...
Wait.
Actually, if you throw dirt in the air, you can make dust. It's not hard.
Tiny
sediments.
You speak Hebrew then. So you speak and understand Hebrew then.
Actually, we had it posted in the side right as you left. Because, if you want to do it again, admin, just post what the actual Hebrew was.
Okay, so you're looking at the translator's interpretation of what that word is from Hebrew to English. But you do realize, though, when you go from one language to the next, that there is some stuff that's taken out.
I agree that there are some things taken out. So how is dust different from Hebrew than it is in English? Could you explain that?
Okay, again... Can you please tell me how is the dust that's used in the Bible not what you're talking about in science?
I'm saying this is not my claim, Vekel. This is your claim that it's somehow different. You actually have to substantiate that, not me.
You might have to rewind it for him a bit.
Yeah.
Let me try to sum it up. What Drag's saying is that the components, like the elements that are in the earth,
it doesn't go.
The majority of that is not what humans are made of. Humans are mostly made up of carbon. what's mostly comes from the earth, he's saying, is silicone. If we were silicone-based organisms, then the Bible's account of man coming from dust of the ground would make more sense.
If the Bible said it used some other scientific term that says that we are made of,
it's not about the scientific term. It's about the.
You know what? I would like to say something here, Veckel. It just amazes me. Hang on, Veckel. It amazes me that you're sitting here.
Refrain from the attacks, please.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Veckel, it amazes me that you're sitting here complaining about what the Hebrew term is for a certain word when I've heard you go back and use Hebrew terms to define your point and prove your point.
That's right.
But now you're going against that and saying we don't know.
Absolutely.
And other times you say we do know.
Absolutely not.
Pick up my mind, please.
Absolutely not, sir. Absolutely.
Okay, so and that's fine. So
Bob, if you're not understanding the argument, okay? When an atheist makes a claim against the Bible, let's say, for instance, they look at a verse and they say, aha, I prove the immorality of God. Okay, and then I ask them to read it in context. They don't want to do that. They want to just read it at surface level and say, no, we don't need to read it as, you know, we don't need to go into hermeneutics or exegesis. Let's just read it at surface level and then accept it as the way it is. But then I'd say, let's go into the Hebrew and see what it actually says, what the author intended, okay? Now, when we go into words, certain words, like the word dust of the earth, well, to me, that seems to be pretty ambiguous. I mean, can it be taken as a simple dirt from the ground? Sure, of course it could. But, again, I don't see how that term, dust of the earth, is contrary to what Dragnut is bringing up regarding what he studied.
How is dust ambiguous?
How is dust ambiguous? Again, yes. If you're reading it from the Hebrew and accepting it as a primitive language, okay, there's no problem with them using this type of terminology when you really know what it actually says. Just like, give you an example. J.D. Kane and some other atheists brought up this issue, another supposed contradiction in the Bible, saying that the moon is a light source. Okay, the Bible does not say that it's a light source in the same sense that the sun is. It's just simply saying that it's a source of light during the night. Okay, does it provide light? Yes, but that light is not coming from the moon. It's coming from the sun, reflecting off the moon. But since the sun and the moon are not up at the same time all the time, we see just the moon at night. So is that a contradiction? No, it's just simply another way of understanding what the authors have written. They wrote it in a very primitive fashion, and it's perfectly fine. And I say the same thing could be said for the dust of the earth. Did they go into scientific explanations as to what exactly we're made of? No. So the Bible is not a science book. It just simply says dust of the earth, that's all.
Okay, I'm actually reading something very interesting here. The term is afar, and there seems to be several places in the Bible where afar is mentioned, but I'm scrolling down here. The website is goddidn'tsaythat.com, and it's Bible translations and mistranslations. And so this is very interesting. And I'll go down to the bottom here where it gives different.
Website? Just curious.
Huh?
Is that website that you went to, is that an atheist website, or I'm just curious?
What if it has Greek and Hebrew translation? What does it matter?
No, you said God didn't say that. What is that, an atheist website?
Does it? Why? Okay, I love this genetic fallacy you're hinging on here, but what should it matter unless it has valid translations?
Wait, Dragnut, before you accuse me of committing a fallacy, you haven't heard me commit a fallacy yet.
I said before you're on the precipice of doing that.
I've already heard a fallacy. Several. You've spoiled the pitch about four times.
I can't ask a question?
Okay,
I'm just saying you have committed fallacies. You've spoiled the pitch at least four times.
Wait, so I can't ask a question? It's fallacious to ask a question?
I just posted Strong's concordance definition of it. If you look at there, it's a short definition of dust.
But we're dragging it. Before you move on, because I really do want to hear what you have to say, but I'm just asking one simple question, and I promise we're not going to go off on that. Is it an atheist website, yes or no? And please, can you send me the link?
Actually, let me double check. It doesn't look like one. By Joel M. Hoffman. It's his website. PhD in theoretical linguistics, has taught Bible in religious settings at Brandeis University. He's often a chief translator to a widely read My People's Prayer book. Winner of the National Jewish Book Award. Author of the critically acclaimed Beginning, A Short History of the Hebrew Language.
Okay.
It looks religious, like a religious person. So again, what does that have to matter with anything at all?
It's just an inquiry. That's it. Can you send me the link?
Sure.
Okay. Thank you. Actually,
you can read the bottom of that for me, last three sentences.
All right. Let's take a look.
Actually, the second to last quote will do.
Okay, I'm gonna really take. I've never seen this website before, so I'm gonna take some time to look at this when I get some good time to do it.
That's
actually in the process of getting ready for work. But let me read the. You said the bottom.
The second to last sentence.
All right. Let's see. So afar seems to refer generally to any granular material, and in particular to the granular material on the surface of the earth. Additionally, it symbolizes humanity. In English, we usually call that dirt. Okay.
Well, look at that.
So this is one person's interpretation of life. Right?
Okay, why
is that funny? Isn't that how science works?
Here's what's cool. Here's what's cool. Look on the right-hand side of the screen.
Isn't that how science works?
Oh, no, that's right. No, we can find concordance. No, that's fine. I'm agreeing. I'm agreeing with you.
You got the peer review. So you don't have just one person's opinion on to dictate what something actually means or what actually is, right? You have several opinions, okay? So
that's fine. Look on the right-hand side of the screen.
No, I'm going to accept it. That's fine, but this is just one person. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, that's fine. And Bob found another source. Look on the right-hand side of the screen. Could you read that for me?
On the right-hand side of the screen?
Yep. Okay. On the group chat.
Oh, okay. Hold on 1 second.
For those watching, the term is afar, A-F-A-R. That's the Hebrew word being used as far as the dust is concerned.
Wait, I don't see. When did you post it? Because I don't see the link.
Okay, Bob posted it. Okay, word origin from an unused word definition: dry earth, dust. NASB translation: ashes, debris, dirt, dry soil, dust, dusty earth, ground, heap, loose earth, plaster, rubbish, rubble. From BibleHub.com, Hebrew. BibleHub.com/Hebrew/6083.htm. Again, we see same meaning for dust that it is in English.
Okay.
Would you like another source?
Yeah, go ahead. I have these same sources, by the way. And that's not refuting my argument. Okay, again, what you're looking at here are just basic translations from one word to the next. I mean, from one language to the next. That's all you're looking at here. All right? That's why you have some words here.
Okay, and the issue you had earlier was that there's a difference between how words are translated from one language to another, correct?
Well, when some words, for those of you who speak multiple languages, you know that there's some things that you can't say in English that can be said in a different language, and vice versa.
Yeah, and a good example of that is in Japanese, the concept of yugen. There's no English there's no way to translate that in English. I agree.
Not so with dust.
So, with the word afar, dirt. But again, what you're looking at it to me seems to be it just giving you a very basic definition of what afar means. That's it. It doesn't go into detail in science like what you did before and tells you what the human is made of. It just simply says dirt.
Okay, and so when this dust is being referenced and it says it means dry earth, is there another type of dry earth that is now being referenced?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that it's just using a very simplistic term to say what we're made of. That's it.
And that's fine. So is there a different chemical composition of that dust than the dust we have now?
Trying to tell you, it doesn't go into those type of details. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, so we know.
And it doesn't need to.
And that's fine, because you know what's interesting is that if there was a different composition of what the dust is then and now, we'd have evidence for that. What you were trying to sit here and posit is that there's a different type of dust that they're somehow referencing, but yet there's no evidence for such a thing.
I'm positing that you're jumping to conclusions to asserting that there's an error there when it doesn't give you any specific detail. It just simply a very simplistic term, dust of the earth.
That's fine. And we know what that dust is, do we not?
Right here, because if you don't want to accept that, that's fine. I understand.
I mean, no. Do we know what dust is made of? Yes or no?
A contradiction. I think you could pick up something else.
Do we know what dust is made of?
Again, it's not a legitimate contradiction. I'm just simply.
Okay. Do we know what dust is made of?
Very simple language to me.
Do we know what dust is made of, Iveco? It's a really easy question. I know you're uncomfortable right now, and it's fine. But do we know what dust is made of?
I love talking to atheists, but we don't need to.
We don't need to. Oh, okay. That's not my question. Do we know what it's made of? What is dust made of, Veckel?
We don't need to understand it in order to understand what the Bible's actually trying to convey.
Okay, so cool. So we know what dust is, and don't we know how to break it down and find out what it's made of?
No, the Bible doesn't prohibit us from wanting to study these things out. However,
I must be speaking Greek.
A legitimate contradiction. That's
okay. So, and you're still avoiding my question. Do we know what dust is made of?
But I already answered this question.
No, you did not. You're avoiding it for like the fifth time.
No, I'm not avoiding it. I said I don't know.
You don't know. Okay. Is there anyone on this planet Earth that knows what dust is made of?
Dust of the ground. That's it.
Okay, do we have someone that could, I don't know, possibly find out what it's made of?
Okay. Well, you have the internet. You could search it for yourself real quick.
We do. Silicon dioxide. And Helena is right. Mm. Okay. He could have picked carbon since plants supposedly came first. Would need carbon for that. I just find it interesting, though. I like harping on these points because it makes Christians really uncomfortable, and they have to stray away from the questions.
No, you should. I'm not uncomfortable at all, actually.
You are. That's why you haven't answered the question that I've asked like five times.
You just don't like the answer.
You've done everything but answer.
That's not going to work on me, bro. That's not going to work on me, bro.
Oh, I know. Cognitive dissonance is strong with this one.
None of y'all. Okay? Y'all don't have anything to bring to the table that's going to destroy anybody's faith here. But again,
I didn't say I was trying to.
Dust of the ground. That's it. That's all. To me, it's really that simple. I don't need to. The Bible is not claiming to be a science book. It's not used as a science book.
Didn't say it was.
It's giving you a very simplistic idea of where man came from. That's all. It doesn't go into detail. And I'm perfectly fine with that. There's a lot of things about God and that's explained in the Bible that we don't understand, and I'm perfectly fine with some of this in the world.
It's really sad.
Why are we still paying taxes?
Really sad.
You would say that. Yep. Thank you.
Yeah. What the thing Helena said about the carbon being from the plants.
I love it.
Wouldn't that only be if the plant died and decayed in the dirt? You get the carbon from the plants in the dirt. And since there was no death at that time, then there wouldn't be no carbon from the plants in the dirt.
Oh, Bob.
Hold on. Dirt could have had bits of actual plant, bits of roots in it. It just says dirt.
Yeah, I mean, that's fair.
It's not a great one, but it does point out that if you would just do a tiny bit, even a little bit of chemistry, so you knew sort of how stuff sticks to carbon and stuff like that, it would be easy. It would be easy to deal with on this particular issue, and you wouldn't have to go into Hebrew and stuff like that.
I understand, and guys, I don't want you to get me wrong because I am not, and you have not heard me in any hangout. Try to get people away from studying these things out. Because as a matter of fact, I always say the complete opposite. The Bible actually commands us and commends when we actually search these things out. So we're not against science. We're not against people searching these things out. My issue is when a person says that there's a contradiction or error in the Bible, I ask them to substantiate it. And so far, I haven't heard it. All I heard was the Bible says dust of the ground, that's one side, and then the other side says that science says this is what humans are made of. Okay, fine. But to me, that's not a strong contradiction or a strong dichotomy. All we see is the Bible saying dust of the earth. That's it.
When you have to know what dust is made of in order to draw that conclusion?
If you want to know, if you want that detail, sure. But again, the Bible doesn't get it.
Well, how do you know what it's referencing if you don't know what it is?
Oh, I don't know. It just simply says dust of the earth.
So it could be a cow, for all you know.
It says dust of the earth.
So what are you attaching? What is dirt?
What is your understanding of that? When you say dust of the earth, what is your understanding?
It just says dust of the earth.
No, but what is your understanding like?
Okay, I've already answered this question too, okay? The reason why you guys think I'm avoiding is because you're not listening. I said that I don't know.
Now.
Okay, all I said is the Bible says dust of the earth.
So when you read that on, when you read that passage,
just hang on a second.
Hold on a second. When you read that passage, Beckel.
Right now, I need to say this right now.
Beckel, that's it.
Sorry, guys. Hold on. Right, really, we need to just stop saying things like that, Beckel. You understand what I'm talking about?
I'm sorry, man, but I really can't. I do it all the time,
Beckel. I'm not trying to accuse you of being like really bad or anything. I'm just saying, let's watch it.
Okay, well, I tell you what, I'll watch it if you watch it. How about that?
I'll try.
Okay, great. We got a deal.
So, Beckel, okay, you just said something interesting to me, which was basically, even the point that I brought up is relatively irrelevant to you, right? So, I mean, the fact that, let's suppose there literally was no carbon, right? It still wouldn't matter because you're making a different point. Which I'm not sure I can, you know, support or go along with.
Well, Jesus says we can come to him as a child, father. That means that we can come to him in the most extremely simplistic faith, and we can establish a relationship with this God, okay? That doesn't mean that that is the only way that you can come to Christ. I mean, you can come to Christ through any various different means. You know, we have extremely, extremely intelligent people who are in the church, who are, you know, philosophers, scientists, and stuff like that. Of course, you probably deny that and their status, but the fact of the matter is these people are very, very intelligent, way more apt to have this discussion than I ever will, that I can even dream of. And you'd be better off talking to those guys. But to me, you're talking to a simpleton here. At least I admit it. Maybe you should too, but it says dust of the ground. That's it. As a matter of fact, Peripheral Prophets here, he actually has some study in the area of botany, I think. He may be able to better explain what the Bible says itself, or maybe he comes to a very simplistic conclusion as I do as well. It says dirt. Doesn't go into detail, folks. That's it.
What's the complaint?
I don't think Helena's question was actually answered, but anyway.
Hopefully you guys understand my point. Okay, my point is real, really simple. It's
obviously
the earth and Christ.
Could we just
silicone? Okay, the Bible, the word silicone is not used in the English text. It's not used in the Hebrew.
Wasn't even invented.
I don't see a problem. Right.
What was Helena's question again? Because if that wasn't answered, I think I'd really like to go to that point.
Helena asked him understanding.
I was getting tired. I was like, you know, jumping up and down because. Drag, and he said, he admits, is not the right word, but you know, agrees, that his argument about silicone, because silicone is the most diverse element in soil, right? So, but that God should have, if we were creatures based in silicone, because things stick to silicone almost as well as carbon, then the Bible would be more in line with what we know. And I was jumping up and down because I was like, that's pretty easily diffused because doesn't the Bible say that plants came first? And if plants came first, boom, you have carbon. So God could just pick carbon. But what was interesting was that then Beckel was making a point that, you know, even if my argument was flawed and bad, or even if there was absolutely no carbon anywhere, so that Drag's comment was absolutely 100% irrefutable, it wouldn't make any difference to Veckel. And that is what's interesting to me.
Oh, yeah.
It would matter to me because if we see something completely contrary what's being said here. But again, how do we know? Let's first of all understand what a contradiction is or a dichotomy is. You have something, one says this, another one says that. Okay? It'd be one thing if the Bible says that we're all made of oranges. And when we're not, or if we're all made of a, let's say, a piece of metal or a car or something like that, when science says the complete opposite. But this example of the dust of the earth is that's not a legitimate contradiction. All the Dragnut and everybody else is doing is looking at the ingredients of that make up the human body, and then comparing that to the simple term dust of the earth.
I mean, if I could just say real quick, he never did claim that there was a contradiction. He was saying that there's an error, not a contradiction, just that there's an error.
But it sounds like he's pointing out a contradiction. Though he says it's
I did not. I would have used that word if I wanted to say that. I purposely avoided the word contradiction.
Oh, okay. Well, but to me, it sounds like a contradiction because you're saying the Bible says one thing while science says another. Hmm. So there's a contradiction, not within itself, but between the Bible and science, according to you.
Yeah, no, there's a difference between a contradiction and a mistake, right? He was just saying that to me, the way I read it, and I know he never did imply this, but I added this part, was that if there's a mistake, so it's people that wrote it, people who didn't know anything about chemistry at the time, right? So it's just people that wrote it, and that's pretty obvious, because the dust would be hardly any carbon, and you'd have to sort of point out that there could be some carbon, blah, blah, blah. So, but he wasn't saying that there was a specific contradiction, just that, in fact, here's an example where it's pretty clear that there's a mistake going on.
Yeah, but be that as it may, even if it wasn't a legitimate mistake, how is something like that, or why even bring something like that up in a discussion, in an attempt to debunk the Bible? I mean, I would point you to other areas. I can point out to allegedly better contradictions than or better errors.
Again, it's not a contradiction, but go ahead.
I said, okay, errors. Okay.
So
errors than the one that was pointed out. That's what I'm saying.
Would you bring it up because you find the ones that are less indefensible or that you personally don't have a background in chemistry?
Well, both actually.
So you know? since I do, I would like to start from the beginning and go toward the end, and I do know a little bit about chemistry. You know, why not? Let's start at the.
Oh.
Right. Let's start at the claim. Yeah. The beginning when God spoke things into existence, and let's just go from there.
Okay. Well, I understand that. That's cool. It's just that to me, when the Bible uses a simple term like dust of the earth. To me, that seems rather ambiguous. I think it could be taken a lot of places from that point on, especially when you guys claim that they didn't study chemistry back then. Okay, I'll grant you that. If that's the case, why is it wrong for them to use such simplistic terms to say this is what humans were made of?
Because it would seem to be an error with what we know in science. It cannot be. If it would be the case that it could be substantiated. We could actually prove that, yes, we are created from the dust of the earth, which I'm not sure how it's ambiguous, but would be granules or particulates, I think they're called, that are from the earth, from the ground, that are in the air sometimes. So we could have been silicone-based, and that would actually substantiate that particular claim.
Yeah, but we were – okay. There would be processes that God would have had to have employed. He would have had to take material, right, and actually, you know, create processes during that, utilizing that material to form a human, right? He didn't literally, like, take a piece of phosphorus and a piece of calcium and, like, stick them together and form this human out of, like, you know, particles. It wasn't like that. There was obviously a deeper process involved, right? So what we're saying is that God used the matter that he created the earth from
to create humans, which is how humans are created, right? Whenever you procreate, for example, the food that your wife eats to create that baby either comes from animals who eat the plant matter, or she eats the plant matter directly. Plants synthesize nutrients from the ground and pull them into themselves. Basically, they're made out of the dirt. They're using all of the chemical elements that we're eating and consuming. So it's a different process for how we build children in the womb of a woman, whereas God would have bypassed that, just used the elements available straight up. I don't know if that makes any sense, but it sounds like I don't know what's the argument, like, that there's not a scientific explanation for how God did it. Well, that's kind of obvious.
It sounds almost peripheral, and I'm going to let you fix me on this, but it sounds kind of like you're saying, hold on, God is magic, and you're forgetting the magic part.
I'm not saying God is magic. I mean, what's your definition? I think magic or parlor tricks or something like that.
Supernatural.
Okay, supernatural, yes. I would be saying God is, in fact, supernatural, and employed a technique native only to himself, obviously, to create the first human life from the matter of the earth and what he had already created prior to that, because we are physical. I mean, if you extrapolate all of the water, all of the gases from our flesh, mm-hmm. you're left with mineral nutrients, are you not?
I'm sorry, I didn't listen to you because I was waiting to say something. Say that again.
Okay, if you take all of the water out of our bodies, right? Take it all out.
Yeah.
What are you left with? You're left with what? Calcium.
Carbon phosphorus, nitrogen, carbon, stuff like
right,
that.
All yeah. of these different minerals, right?
Right, so, the stuff that sticks to carbon, yeah.
Okay, so that's just matter. That's all that is. It's not supernatural. It's what you find on planet Earth anyway. So I think that's what we're talking about. Now the actual processes, because I think Drag said there would be chemical processes that would take place, obviously. So I don't really know how that part happened, because that's something that God would have had to, he would understand that. I don't understand how he did that.
Okay, I mean, if we understand it
through, how a child is formed in the womb and how mineral nutrients are consumed and collated and things like that. So,
we can posit the supernatural. That's fine. The issue here is that there is a connection between the two parts that supposedly created Adam was one supernatural with the breath, and then the material from the dust that actually formed a physical being of a human. And so my issue is that since the earth, the crust of it, is 90% silica, which is silicon dioxide, it would seem more likely that we would be silicone-based, as far as not our composition, but the chemical bonds that make up, like, our epithelial tissue, for example. That makes sense.
Okay. I don't really...
I'm
not really sure what you're talking about.
Okay, so if you know we're made... I'll break it. Let's see. We have protein in our body, and that protein makes up different organs, tissues, and whatnot, correct? Like protein and carbohydrates?
Yes.
Okay. They are formed from complex chemical chains. These chains are bound together by the element of carbon. Now, if we were made physically from the dust from the earth, we would instead have silicone as this base for these chains instead of that carbon. That is the issue that I'm bringing up here.
Okay. So you think that we should, if the Bible's true, we should be silicone-based, basically, is what you're saying.
Yeah, that's exactly basically. It.
Yes.
That's
okay.
Yes. If the Bible's true, we would be silicone-based, because almost everything in dirt is silicone, right? So... I think that's what he's saying.
I mean, if I'm not mistaken, is it SiO2 is the chemical, or is the for silicone? Is that
yeah, silicone dioxide? Yes,
SiO2, I think, off the top of my head.
SiO2, yes.
So okay.
I think that's one of the compounds that we do use. I mean, it's part of our makeup. Same with plants. I mean, so I don't know, you know, to what degree SI is part of our makeup. Somebody who's probably a little more studied than that would have to tell me. But I mean, I do know it's. I'm sure it has to be a component of our makeup. It's probably not as much, obviously, as calcium, but, you know.
So wait, so Perif, when it says dust of the earth, how do you take that? How do you accept that?
Bro? I just take it very simply. It means that we're created from the matter that the planet is made out of, quite simply. I don't try to break it down into, like, certain chemical elements and whatever. Right. I don't try to presume how God, what supernatural process God used to create different, you know, interactions with different mineral nutrients and chemicals and all that stuff. I don't even think about that kind of stuff.
Yeah, me too. I mean, that's all I was pointing out. I mean, I'm not. And again, guys, don't get us wrong. We're not saying that the Bible prohibits people from searching these things out. Again, I would argue that the Bible says the complete opposite. It wants us to search these things out. So in the end, we end up glorifying God even more. But the fact of the matter is, when we're arguing about the simplistic term, dust of the earth, dust of the ground, whatever, that's all it says, folks. That's it. It doesn't go into detail. A lot of atheists ask, well, if God created the earth or God created the universe, how did he do it? It doesn't say how. It just says that he did. It doesn't give you any specific details of what compound he used. It just says that he spoke it.
Well, maybe this may not be the issue for some. I'm naturally inquisitive. Naturally, I just taking people's word for it. That's really not good enough for me in most cases. Mm-hmm. So when there is a claim and I'm within the realm of possibility for me to verify it, I want to check it out. In this case, it seems inconsistent with the claim and reality. And just to kind of give you illustration, this is a goat protein. But you see how you see all these C's in here? These C's are holding everything together. There'll be an SI instead of that C. That's really what I'm talking about.
Okay, what's this we're looking at? Dust or
what? No, this is a goat. This is a protein. This is a goat protein actually. Oh, okay. But this is a chain. And so this chain is being held together by these C's. These C's represent carbon. My issue is that these C's should be SI. Because SI is found in dust of the earth.
Yeah, but that's a protein. What about, like, are you looking into, like, the bone structure? I mean, is there any silicon in the bone structure at all? I mean, this is not, I'm not, you know.
That's actually a good question.
The anatomy of humans is not something I'm too familiar with. I mean, but yeah, I wouldn't expect to find much silicon in a protein. But now in maybe bone structures, I would think that, or I don't know, maybe some kind of other organs or something. I don't know.
Yeah, and that was the other thing too. Maybe when it was written, when it said the term "dust of the earth" was used, maybe it's just using that one word afar in a general sense, referring to all of the elements. I think Griff, you already said that. It could be just referring to all of the elements rather than just one particular element. I don't know, but it just simply says "dust of the earth."
Yeah, I mean, well, and that's fine. I mean, we can say that, you know, dust meant something else if that's actually in the text, it's somewhere. But from what it seems like, you wanted to go to the Hebrew translation, and we found two different versions that said it literally meant dirt from the ground. And unless there is another place that is absent of carbon being there, then I'm not seeing how you're avoiding acknowledging that there may be an issue here with this.
Well, anybody who studies Hebrew, and again, I don't speak Hebrew, I don't read or write it. However, I have studied the concordance long enough and other sources to know that the Hebrew language is just as homonymic as the English and the Greek. So again, it's okay for them to use the word afar in different forms, in different manners. And that, so again, the word afar to mean a generalized combination of something. You know, just simply saying, well, God used this and this and this, put that with there, and then he used this, this, and this, and put that with there. Why not just use a generalized term to say, let's call it dust? You know, it's still saying the same thing. There's no contradiction. It's just not going as strong.
I didn't say it was a contradiction again, but the issue here, if you go back to the website, there's actually all the instances of a FAR. Dr. Joel M. Hoffman goes through and eliminates possibilities each time the word afar occurs in the Bible. And so he even goes to Genesis 2:7, right. And he says, so Genesis 2:7 should read, the Lord God formed man from the dirt of the ground. I mean,
I'll look at that source and I'll compare it to some of the sources that I have, and I'm pretty sure they may end up doing the same thing. But I don't have a problem with the generalized term dirt being used.
That's fine with me too, because go ahead.
What happens to the body when it decays? I mean, does it turn into mush? Does it look like something like a rotten apple, or does it turn into something that looks like dust?
I can't find what the actual chemical makeup of bones are, other than silicon is, it's necessary for our bone structure. So I don't know what the levels are.
Yeah, I just
no. It's actually a derivative. It's not actual silicone, right? It's some derivative. Because silicone won't easily make different bonds. It doesn't. It's not pliable. Does that make sense? So there is something like it, but it's just a derivative. It's not actual.
Silicon is one of the most abundant elements in the universe, and is fundamental to the basic bone and skeletal structure of each and every one of us. I'm trying to find something on this. I'm not really sure. Again, I'd have to study so much stuff to really put together
I looked it up on one chart, and it says silicone makes up less than 1% of the human body. Less than 1%.
I mean, yeah, I never said it wasn't in there. It's just as far as our chemical bonds are concerned, to me, we should be silicone-based. And actually, it's funny. I was listening to a lecture on astrobiology and what kind of life forms that we should expect to find in other planets. And one of the possibilities was a silicone-based organism, just because of how many chemical bonds it can form that's close to the number that carbon can.
That's so funny. That's one of the daydreams I have. Like, I think, you know, everyone always talks about carbon-based life, but I would imagine there would be a silicone-based life. So it's really cool that... to hear that other people are saying that.
Well, guys, I'm going to ask a real simple question. Okay, real simple, because that's all that can do in this discussion, is what happens to the body after it dies?
So it's an apple. It's like a rotten apple. Then it's like dust.
Yes, if you leave a human body...
Material, right?
Do we turn into a rotten apple, or do we turn into dust? Well, we go through a rotten apple stage, and then
Right, when you excavate and you see skeletons, what happened to the flesh? Where's the flesh? Why is it just a bone?
It biodegrades.
Well, rotten apple. It was rotten apple, and then it interacted with the stuff that was touching it, and animals came and stuff like that.
Put a body out in the desert, and leave it there long enough without it being covered, and it'll eventually just disintegrate.
Yeah, exactly, disintegrate, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it'll look like a dust-like material of some sort, right? I mean, the skin doesn't just fall off a body and go wobble somewhere else. No, it actually disintegrates.
Yes, so, but it goes through a rotten apple stage. I mean, you're not saying it doesn't.
Well, it doesn't actually.
But what I'm saying, ultimately, why could not the author who put the term dust of the earth, why couldn't he not look at a decomposed body after that process and say, oh, okay, this is what we're made of, and use that?
Yeah, he probably did. I mean, for Drag is interested more in the mechanics of it and how could it have been possible and that kind of thing. For me, as an atheist, it's like a bullhorn that this is a person with less knowledge than us, or people with less knowledge than us, doing their best to make scientific sense out of things. So then it makes me question divinity, right? That's not divinely inspired. That mistake can't be divinely inspired. It's just some people doing their best.
That's what it seems like.
I guess we're just at an impasse because I don't see a mistake. I think that if properly reduced, the human body would essentially return to the dust of the earth, if that's how you wanted to say it. I think you could say that the human body is made of all of the elements that the earth contains, obviously, or else we wouldn't be producing children. So, you know, what those proportions are, if you're concerned with that and that's the defeater for you personally, hey, I guess we're at an impasse.
Actually, I'm glad that Dragula has this inquiry because, again, you know, like I always say, I love talking to atheists because it actually poses a challenge to the faith, and it gets people who are professing to be of Christ to really think about why they believe what they believe. Are you believing it because your mama made you go to church, or are you believing it because you have strong faith in what this book says?
Or people are just scared.
And I commend you guys for bringing up these objections and these questions. So I would not encourage you to stop doing it. I actually encourage you to keep doing it. But I would also encourage you to repent and turn to Christ and get to know Him and get to know your God better.
Okay. When you do that, I'm going to tell you right now, that's really disrespectful.
How is it disrespectful?
Okay. For one thing.
Mark on your face. That's why.
Okay, so when you go, you need to repent. You need to turn. I don't like this idea of self-depreciation. I really gets on my last nerve. I'm just throwing it out there. I understand you feel that everyone's a sinner and we need to praise this deity in order for us to be worth something. But to me, that's self-depreciation. I'm just throwing it out there.
Well, the Bible says that you would have that attitude.
I honestly don't. The Bible can't even get basic chemistry right, so it really doesn't matter that much to me.
Well, the Bible's not making an assertion about chemistry. hold on. What I wanted to say was that
that's inherent right there.
The Bible says God created the heavens and the earth, but it doesn't say what the supernatural interface with the temporal was in order to create the heavens and the earth. Does that make it not true? Absolutely not. It just means that it doesn't describe what only a God would know in order to do that, you know, have this process take place. How could we understand things from God's perspective? We're not God.
It doesn't describe that because the people at the time that they wrote it didn't know. That's
why. How do you know that just because?
Thing about God.
Hold on, Duckle. People today. Human beings could not comprehend today how God did it, let alone the people that authored the Bible. What do you mean? Because you're not God. You're the created, not the creator.
Well, so what? That doesn't mean you're comprehended.
You lack the supernatural intellectual prowess to understand the supernatural. Right?
Yeah, but by that logic, peripheral, God didn't know either.
Well, if he's God and he's omniscient, he has all knowledge, and you are human and not have all knowledge and are not omniscient, then you don't know.
He can't tell us. All he can do is make meaningless statements about metaphoric things that possibly could have happened in some possible way.
Or God is omniscient,
wide enough. Or we can pretend that, you know, the primitive people somehow had this idea that an all-powerful deity needed physical dirt to create humans instead of just raw power and magic. I like that idea. We can pretend like that's not inconsistent with reality all day, but at the end of the day... At the end of the day, you're still relying on magic to help prove your point, and piling assertions on top of it doesn't make it valid.
Well, no, Drag, I agree. From a natural... If you're a philosophical naturalist, if you don't believe in anything supernatural and that the universe is eternal, it's always existed, there is no supernatural answer for where it came from, then sure, you're going to struggle to have this idea that there is a supernatural interface taking place at some point, right? Or that God himself... And how do you choose... How do you know what a God chooses to do with how he creates? If he creates a universe, he creates the matter, and then he decides he's going to use the matter as a platform for life. Well, how do you have any say whatsoever in what he chooses to do?
Because if he is, in fact, interfacing with reality, there would be evidence of it. And that's why my entire example...
Well, that's what reality is. That is the evidence. But most people don't...
No, that is not. What you're trying to do is misunderstand what I'm saying. If, in fact, that there is some type of supernatural force that is digging into this reality and warping things, then there would be evidence to point to it. In this case, if there was an SI on those chemical bonds instead of a C, that would in fact back your claim. So I'm not at any point saying that this cannot be proven or that, you know, this is impossible. I am saying that reality goes against your claim.
I think you're applying a standard that doesn't necessarily follow. You're saying it would have to be silicone based. Why?
Is he digging into reality? The laws, the natural laws of this earth?
Well, who says that he has to do anything, though? You're saying that he has to create life and make it silicone-based because silicone is abundant, but how does that follow? I don't understand why. Like, why do you make the choice and not God in that case?
I'm not saying I made the choice. I'm saying that if he has to work within the confines of this reality in order to do things, then he has to use what's available, which is completely
fine. That's what he did.
And if he did indeed use something that's available, that it wouldn't make sense for him to pull something that was less abundant, way less abundant, from something that's way more abundant. It doesn't logically follow for a deity to do that, especially if he
according
knows
to
people.
Standards, you're not a deity. You don't have the standard of deity to judge him by.
Here's the fun part. If he honestly wanted and knew that people were going to go in and research this stuff, that's a tidbit he could have purposely put in there in order to verify what's being said, because he knew people during that time did not know chemistry, but he knew people later on would eventually learn it and find and connect these dots, which would lead them to faith.
Right, so but you don't have a standard to judge by which
I have
choose. Well, no, you don't. You're not a god. So if God says, I'm going to choose to make life carbon-based, you don't really have an argument to the contrary, other than, well, I think maybe this is what God should have done, but you're not a god. He is.
Stating that I don't have a basis.
I didn't say you didn't have a basis. You have an opinion based on you're looking at evidence. You see this abundance of silicone. And sure, maybe if you were a god, that's what you would have done. But God chose something differently. And you don't really have a leg to stand on to say how he should, according to the biblical narrative, how he should have done things, right? How do you know? You don't. He's a god or not. So there's a problem.
Actually, we do have something. We have something from God himself called reason.
So right? For some reason, humans cannot derive their basis out of just the facts of what is. There has to be another category created for this deity that circumvents logic that's now being posited. And that really flies in the face of anything that a Christian would say that would make logical sense to prove that there is a deity. I mean, you can't circumvent logic to praise God and then try it. And then
try arbiter of logic.
And you can say that all day, but when he flies in the face of what would be logical, then he's not.
Well, if you're defining what is logical and you're in error, then you're falsely assigning a logical fallacy of some sort to God, saying, well, God should have done it this way, but God chose a different way, therefore God is wrong. Well, wait a minute. If God chose to do it that way and he's omniscient, then he had a purpose for it or a reason for it, and you don't have a standard to judge against that.
If I'm in error, is there evidence that you could put forth to show that I am in error, since what I'm saying actually aligns with reality?
Are you omniscient?
Do you have to be? Do you have evidence to show that one has to be in order to be relevant and true?
Well, I'm not saying that. In all
yes, you are. You are exactly saying
you
that I need.
Because
I
God
need.
Is. You
how
aren't.
Does how that's does omniscience true. Add a veracity to my statement?
Well, it doesn't. You don't.
Yeah, thank you. That's my point. No, it doesn't. Exactly. How does omniscience add to the veracity of a statement?
Well, okay. If somebody was omniscient, any statement they purport to say is going to be by definition true because they have all knowledge, whereas you don't. So if you don't have omniscience,
doesn't follow. No, he has to be also truthful and, you know, not be a, you know, devil.
Right, but somebody who has all knowledge is capable of answering all questions to give an answer.
He's telling the truth if he chooses to tell you the truth.
Having the ability to tell the truth, it does not change
whether you have
all knowledge or some knowledge.
Right, we're not talking about a God who's lying. We're talking about a God who has all knowledge.
I'm not talking about God. I'm talking about me.
Humans who have very limited knowledge. I don't even think it's adequate to say that the knowledge possessed by, say, a flea compared to humans is even comprehensible in regards to how much more knowledge God actually has than we do. I mean, we're looking at the universe from the ground up. God's got it all already. We're trying to figure it out from the bottom up, you know? And we're trying to create the standard by which to judge a God and how he decides to do things as if he's somehow wrong because we have a better idea. Well, that doesn't really follow. That's like the guy at the lowest level of the chain of command telling the captain what he thinks he should do. Well, the captain has the bigger picture. You don't. You're at the bottom.
Go ahead, Max.
Oh, just to add my two cents in here. A nice analogy might be, consider this. Imagine if you have Tolkien's huge Lord of the Rings series, and from out of that you just ripped one page, and you just read it without any context to the rest of the book. Now, in terms of judging and critiquing the author, you might have some interesting and maybe even rationally considered such feedback coming from just the analysis of one page, but you'd have to admit, considering that you're missing huge segments of the book and the plot, maybe your analysis, while reasonable considering what you do know, might not be well informed considering all the stuff you don't know. Maybe that's the best way to phrase the analogy to the best of my ability.
Sure, and then for that, you would need evidence that the book itself existed.
Right.
Tolkien is fiction. Maybe we can pick a non-fiction book.
the point of Tolkien's, well, if the page is ripped from the book, the book itself does exist. But I think you raised a point such that let's look at some kind of design flaw. Why does God decide to design our body such that both the waist and the sexual organ are considered one and the same? That seems like a design flaw. Why does such a God decide to create humans in this way as opposed to this much better way? And now, considering just the body taken alone in itself in isolation from the rest of the universe and creation, I could totally see why that criticism comes up. But considering that a human being lives as a character, or humans live as characters described partially, perhaps there is some kind of more cosmological reason or more emergent reason such that they have the limbs that they do and the design that they do. They have to participate as actors within history, and maybe their biology partakes in some way. For example, why do people's feet get tired? Well, it just so happens that they do. Considering the weight that's put on them and how they might be weaker by comparison. That seems like a design flaw, but perhaps it led Rosa Parks at one point in history to consider, man, I'm tired. I might as well just sit in front of the bus. Like, that greater thing came out of it. Now I'm not saying that that's what actually happened, but just concocting this relationship between something that might seem problematic in itself, but when taken into the greater context of creation as a whole, might seem to make a lot more sense. And considering God has the full view of that, we might not be in a position to judge up until the point where we can see it from a perspective similar to his.
Sure, I could sit and assert also that any proposition put forth by anyone else is erroneous because they also do not contain the information from a standard that I myself has set for them. So if I have a professor that says, well, you know what, X, Y equals Z, my retort to him would be that since you did not go throughout the entire alphabet and the alphabet that you have yet to discover, you cannot therefore draw such a conclusion. The issue here is that I would have to then prove that there is an extended alphabet in order that would comply with the context of whatever it is that we're talking about. I mean, but I could literally posit any criteria that I want in order to downplay the evidence that is already presented when no one can actually prove that such a criteria is even valid.
Right, actually, and you can. So we actually do recognize that some authorities have more extensive knowledge than we do. So let's say that you're in a, I'm not sure if you've ever been in a classroom where there's always this one guy who was skeptical of what the professor had to say. Maybe a science class on evolution where this kid kept putting up his hand about what the professor didn't know and always remaining skeptical of said professor. Maybe not even for religious reasons, maybe just saying, well, what do you scientists really know? You pretend imposter this, you're teaching us this, but you're not taking into account maybe some other scenario. Or he tries to entertain the professor every time with some hypothetical scenario that he assumes was never explored by the scientists. Well, the professor himself is just trying to teach everyone there the basics. The point is, you realize that certain people do have more extensive knowledge than you do. And, of course, sometimes this knowledge is even counterintuitive. But the point of the matter is, there's going to be a time and place where you cannot get access to it because you don't know the more basic stuff, up until you could actually know the more advanced stuff. So maybe even learning the more basic stuff would be pertinent to learning the more advanced stuff later on. Now, so there are, so situations such as that.
Have my mic off. The issue here is that, yes, you can have a scenario in which not all information has been granted, been the person presenting it has not been necessarily forthcoming. Right. This person, this entity, whatever his organization, could demonstrate that they even do possess it to begin with. I can always claim that, yes, I do have more information than I am putting forth at this point in time. That claim can then be challenged since it is a positive claim. My issue here is that by asserting that there is some type of other that is out there without a verifiable means of gaining access to it, that is putting the metaphysical carrot on the stick in front of us when no such thing actually exists. So should we come to a point where we could prove that this carrot on a stick is actually a goal or a door or some type of entryway to that other, that is when we can actually say, yes, this is a verifiable claim, and that we can actually defer to this method of thinking.
Right, and this is where I think, you make a good point. This would be hypothetical to a being whose existence is, for all intents and purpose, unproven at this point. It is just. Considering God is the creator of the universe, a cause, and we see such an effect, like poor design, then how can we make such a connection? How can we say that there is a bridge between the two? And of course, someone could posit that there might be some extended nature or characteristic of such a cause that might play into this somehow that we don't know, but might have some kind of reason to believe, such as my authority example or analogy, and while that might be possible, it is still only hypothetical because such a being hasn't been proven to exist at the point, and thus it should move to more sturdier ground. That's what I take your position to be, and yeah, I don't really disagree with that.
Hey Max, I gotta go real quick because I gotta go to work, but real quick, I just want to say like. The main problem with naturalists is that they want an explanation or a methodology to test the supernatural. I think that that's a rational approach to, well, can I prove God, at least to myself? I could care less what others believe, but I want to know, does this God exist? What methodology is in play here that I can employ to test for the supernatural?
Well, probability.
Probability is one thing. Hold on real quick. I was going to say that from the biblical position, it tells you how to test these things, okay? It tells you how to understand God, how to be imparted with this truth and have this certainty. It tells you how to do that, but you have to do it according to the Bible standards, right? So that's a methodology that's offered. If you're willing to accept that you are, in fact, a sinner, if you're willing to repent of your sins and accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, okay, then you will be born again. You will receive the spirit of understanding, the spirit of truth, and you will know as you are known as the rest of Christians that have the spirit of God know. And now that's not going to give you the ability to prove it to somebody else once you receive this truth. You're not going to walk around and go, hey, I can prove God to you. It doesn't work like that because they have to have God proven to themselves. But it has to be done by the standards that God has put in place.
The issue is,
go ahead.
There's one big issue with that. It completely lacks objectivity.
So here's what I'll respond to with. Actually, I do think we can have reasonable expectations and see whether or not such a cause can meet those expectations, either for or against. So for God's existence, you might have things such as, consistency in design, the laws of nature, moral sensibilities, spiritual desires, things like that could be argued for it. And on the other hand, you could have evil, hiddenness, you could have things that seem to be very contrary to what we would expect if God is the cause, poor design, things of that nature.
To answer what Drag said, yes, Drag, if I tell you, like, okay, I know God exists, you're going to take that as a subjective statement, and I would expect you to. But for me, it's objective, just in the same way that if you became a Christian, you would tell somebody, guys, I finally figured out what these Christians are railing about. I finally get it. I've been converted. I'm now saved, and I know it to be true. They're going to look at you like you're crazy and say, well, that's a subjective statement, Drag, and you're going to be like, no, it's objective. It happened to me. I know it's true. So I expect it to be considered subjective, right, when I'm saying this, and that's fine, but again, it's on a personal basis. Truth, it doesn't matter what the truth is as long as you know it, and that's all that matters. Who cares if you, it doesn't matter if I can prove something to somebody. There's smaller truths, right, that you could try to convince people till you're blue in the face that money, starving a percentage of the population is a negative thing. There's some people who will never concede to that. They just never will, but we could provide data that says it kills people, it hurts people, but they're still going to do it. Why? Because they're greedy, because of things that we could talk about until we're blue in the face, bro, but at the end of the day, what matters for you? Because it doesn't matter what the consensus is. If the consensus is wrong, ultimately, worry about yourself. Worry about what you believe to be true, and not necessarily... Because everybody else could buy into like this hive mentality of what is true or what's not true, and I think that's a dangerous place to be in. I really do.
I'm not referring to this argumentum ad populum of what comports to truth. When I say something that is true, it is that which corresponds with reality. I can. That the truth of something will have evidence to support it. Doesn't matter what I think or believe. It has nothing to do with it. My personal feelings don't play a role in this.
Right,
I can say that. Yeah.
Yeah, it gets into what is reality at that point, and what if half of the equation is the naturalistic explanation? The science is the naturalistic way of testing and explaining things. But what if there is another part of the equation? Then we're not working with all of the information. We're working with half of the information, or only a portion of it. Let's say it's 99% of it. Who cares? If there's a supernatural cause. Right, and we don't know what that is, but we can look at the effect of it, and we can study it, and kind of like go from. We're still working with limited information. We're still not working with a complete picture. Is all I'm saying.
Yeah, that's why science is a continuous pursuit, and I won't say that we ever have 100% the evidence. I hope we never have 100% the evidence, because then we wouldn't be inspired to go and discover things. I think there's too much stuff out there to do that. But the thing is, this is very interesting. We have actually had instances of science where something is supernatural. The aether, for instance, when we first were discovering how light worked, the aether is a supernatural concept that could not be tested at the time. And it is very interesting that we could actually incorporate a means to test something that is supernatural, and we could set a standard that if
you
something
mean like antimatter or something like that, or
no, antimatter that is actual that we know that exists. But let's say if there is an anomaly, I'll just call it that, and this anomaly we deem sentient, because when we study it, we can actually watch. With intention that it moves from our observation, but it only does this for certain people. So there is no rhyme or reason to this, and that we really want to understand this thing using every tool available. We could relegate it to the realm of supernatural, honestly, should it not fit criteria or any type of equations that we currently hold today as far as physics. So, I mean, it's very possible. It is. I mean, it's not... I hold methodological naturalism provisionally. So, that for that very reason, that is, we've incorporated all types of things into what we now consider the natural world.
Yeah, about the dark matter thing, the team at CERN, the super collider thing, they confirmed dark matter. So yeah.
Well, yeah, dark matter is a that's like a placeholder. I mean, Simon, I think, would be more knowledgeable on that.
Yeah, well, they don't know exactly what it is, but they know it exists. Something like that.
Well, dark matter is a pretty good example. I mean, here you have an effect, but we don't know its cause. So we just say, look, there's a black box here. We don't know what's inside, but we know something's there, right? So that's sort of a great approach to going about it. Nobody says dark matter is a god or supernatural or anything like that. We just don't make those claims. Now, sort of a supernatural explanation is there's just absolutely no way to confirm it. There's just there's nothing that you can do. In fact, how can you discern between something that is unknown and something that's supernatural? Or if you think that there are supernatural things, then how can you discern between one kind of supernatural cause and another supernatural cause? I mean, for example, if there's two gods, they both do supernatural things. So how do you know that it's just coming from one god?
Conversation to see what, but I think what you mean by this.
I think it's kind of a double standard, though, how you sit there and say that, well, you don't understand this because you're not a scientist. You haven't studied it like
when I have. I said this? When did I say it one time that you are not a scientist?
But, Dragna, that's your attitude because that's what you said.
That's my attitude? I say, okay, there's a lot of things that you don't study, Vekel, and I said, you know what? I can offer to help you, and then you don't, you're not interested in help. Well, no, don't tell me what my attitude is, Vekel, because I've offered this. I have offered to help you and G-Man and Arcane on multiple occasions, private and in public.
But Dragna, that was your attitude.
My face. So I don't. So when I have an attitude, because someone, hold on, let me finish.
Smarter than admin, okay? And we're not taking that away from you. We, you know, brother, I appreciate that you studied this issue way more than most people in this hangout. But again, my challenge to everyone here is that how do we know, according to the way it was written by the original author, that the dust of the earth is contrary to what you're proposing?
Okay, and I'm fine, and that is very acceptable. It could mean something different. Is that what you were getting at?
Yes, that's what
okay,
I'm saying.
So, and all I've been trying to do this entire time is find out what that different substance is.
Okay, and like I said, no one knows.
Okay, we can know. We actually can know. We have geological history of the Earth.
No. I'm talking about what the Bible meant when it says dust of the Earth.
What the Bible meant. Okay, so. Does the Bible speak of another substance that is not the Earth's crust?
No, it does not.
Okay, so how are you drawing this conclusion that there was something else when the Bible doesn't speak of something else?
That you're saying that there's an error just because it uses the term dust of the earth. If you don't speak Hebrew, you don't write or understand it, how do you know what exactly dust of the earth actually meant then?
Because we'll have a reference. Just like you said, if it's referring to something else, then we can call that reference based on the information that it gives us, can we not?
So do you know what it meant when Moses or whoever wrote Genesis, what did he mean when he said dust of the earth? What does that mean?
That means what you have underneath your feet walking, that material.
Okay. But you don't accept the fact that because this is a Hebrew, this is a different language. That it could be using it could be using that as an idiom of some sort.
And that's fine.
If
it's referring to something that's not actual dirt, then I am perfectly fine with that. I would just like it defined.
Well, the Bible doesn't have that obligation.
If it doesn't say it, then how are you drawing that conclusion?
Okay, the only conclusion I'm drawing, you've heard me say, was agree with what the Bible says, that the dust of the ground. That's it.
The dust of the ground. Okay. And so if it doesn't indicate that it means something different than what we are commonly referring to as the dirt, how are you posing this opposition against what I'm saying?
Not on surface level. I'm just simply saying that it's using very, very simple language to say what man came from.
And that's fine. And it can use simple language. So from that simple language, where is the inference in Hebrew that you're positing that it is talking about something different.
That's my challenge to you, because you're the one proposing an argument saying that it's contrary to what science proposes. And I'm not saying how is so when it's using very almost ambiguous language here that it's
not dust is not ambiguous. Dust of the earth is not ambiguous. If you pick up dirt and if you throw dirt in the air, you can make dust. It's not hard.
Tiny
sediments.
You speak Hebrew then. So you speak and understand Hebrew then.
Actually, we had it posted in the side right as you left. Because, if you want to do it again, admin, just post what the actual Hebrew was.
Okay, so you're looking at the translator's interpretation of what that word is from Hebrew to English. But you do realize, though, when you go from one language to the next, that there is some stuff that's taken out.
I agree that there are some things taken out. So how is dust different from Hebrew than it is in English? Could you explain that?
Okay, again, can you please tell me how is the dust that's used in the Bible not what you're talking about in science?
I'm saying this is not my claim, Vekel. This is your claim that it's somehow different. You actually have to substantiate that, not me.
You might have to rewind it for him a bit. Let me try to sum it up. What Drag's saying is that the components, like the elements that are in the earth,
it doesn't go.
The majority of that is not what humans are made of. Humans are mostly made up of carbon. What's mostly comes from the earth, he's saying, is silicone. If we were silicone-based organisms, then the Bible's account of man coming from dust of the ground would make more sense.
If the Bible said it used some other scientific term that says that we are made of.
It's not about the scientific term. It's about the dust.
You know what? I would like to say something here, Vekel. It just amazes me. Hang on. Vekel, it amazes me that you're sitting here.
Free from the attacks, please.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Vekel, it amazes me that you're sitting here complaining about what the Hebrew term is for a certain word when I've heard you go back and use Hebrew terms to define your point and prove point.
That's right.
But now you're going against that and saying we don't know.
Absolutely.
And other times you say we do know.
Absolutely
Pick
not.
Pick up my mind, please.
Absolutely not, sir. Absolutely.
Okay, so and that's fine. So
Bob, if you're not understanding the argument, okay? When an atheist makes a claim against the Bible, let's say, for instance, they look at a verse and they say, aha, I prove the immorality of God. Okay, and then I ask them to read it in context. They don't want to do that. They want to just read it at surface level and say, no, we don't need to read it as, we don't need to go into hermeneutics or exegesis. Let's just read it at surface level and then accept it as the way it is. But then I'd say, let's go into the Hebrew and see what it actually says, what the author intended, okay? Now, when we go into words, certain words, like the word dust of the earth, well, to me, that seems to be pretty ambiguous. I mean, can it be taken as a simple dirt from the ground? Sure, of course it could. But, again, I don't see how that term, dust of the earth, is contrary to what Dragnut is bringing up regarding what he studied.
How is dust ambiguous?
How is dust ambiguous? Again,
yes.
If you're reading it from the Hebrew and accepting it as a primitive language, okay, there's no problem with them using this type of terminology when you really know what it actually says. Just like, give you an example. J.D. Cain and some other atheists brought up this issue, another supposed contradiction in the Bible, saying that the moon is a light source. Okay, the Bible does not say that it's a light source in the same sense that the sun is. It's just simply saying that it's a source of light during the night. Okay, does it provide light? Yes, but that light is not coming from the moon. It's coming from the sun, reflecting off the moon. But since the sun and the moon are not up at the same time all the time, we see just the moon at night. So is that a contradiction? No, it's just simply another way of understanding what the authors have written. They wrote it in a very primitive fashion, and it's perfectly fine. And I say the same thing could be said for the dust of the earth. Did they go into scientific explanations as to what exactly we're made of? No. So the Bible is not a science book. It just simply says dust of the earth, that's all.
Okay, I'm actually reading something very interesting here. The term is afar. And there seems to be several places in the Bible where afar is mentioned, but I'm scrolling down here. The website is goddidn'tsaythat.com, and it's Bible translations and mistranslations. And so this is very interesting. And I'll go down to the bottom here where it gives different
website. Just curious,
huh?
Is that website that you that you went to? Is that an atheist website, or I'm just curious?
What if it has Greek and Hebrew translation? What does it matter?
No, you said God didn't say that. What is that, an atheist website?
Does it? Why? Okay, I love this genetic fallacy you're hinging on here, but what should it matter unless it has valid translations?
Wait, Dragon, before you accuse me of committing a fallacy, you haven't heard me commit a fallacy yet.
I said before you're on the precipice of doing that.
I've already heard him. A fallacy. Several. You've spoiled the pitch about four times.
I can't ask a question?
I'm just saying you have committed fallacies. You've spoiled the pitch at least four times.
Wait, so I can't ask a question? It's fallacious to ask a question?
I just posted Strong's concordance definition of it. If you look at theirs, it's a short definition of dust.
But Redragna, before you move on, because I really do want to hear what you have to say, but I'm just asking one simple question, and I promise we're not going to go off on that. Is it an atheist website, yes or no? And please, can you send me the link?
Actually, let me double check. It doesn't look like one. By Joel M. Hoffman. It's his website. PhD in theoretical linguistics, has taught Bible in religious settings at Brandeis University. He's often a chief translator to a widely read My People's Prayer book. Winner of the National Jewish Book Award, author of the critically acclaimed Beginning, A Short History of the Hebrew Language.
Okay.
It looks religious, like a religious person. So again, what does that have to matter with anything at all?
It's just an inquiry. That's it. Can you send me the link?
Sure.
Okay. Thank you.
Actually, you can read the bottom of that for me, last three sentences.
All right. Let's take a look.
Actually, the second to last quote will do.
Okay, I've never seen this website before, so I want to take some time to look at this when I get some good time to do it.
That's actually fine.
Actually, it's the process of getting ready for work. But let me read you said the bottom?
The second to last sentence.
All right, let's see. So afar seems to refer generally to any granular material, and in particular to the granular material on the surface of the earth. Additionally, it symbolizes humanity. In English, we usually call that dirt. Okay.
Well, look at that.
So this is one person's interpretation of what. Right?
Okay, I've got it.
Why is that funny? Isn't that how science works?
Here's what's cool. Look on the right-hand side of the screen.
Isn't that how science works?
Oh, no, that's fine. No, we can find concordance. No, that's fine. I'm agreeing. I'm agreeing with you.
I mean, you got the peer review?
Peer review.
So you don't have just one person's opinion on to dictate what something actually means or what actually is, right? You have several opinions, okay? So
that's fine. Look on the right-hand side of the screen.
No, I'm going to accept it. That's fine, but this is just one person. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, that's fine. And Bob found another source. Look on the right-hand side of the screen. Could you read that for me?
On the right-hand side of the screen?
Yep. Okay. On the group chat.
Oh, okay. Hold on 1 second.
For those watching, the term is afar, A-F-A-R. That's the Hebrew word being used as far as the dust is concerned.
Wait, I don't see. When did you post it? Because I don't see the link.
Oh, okay, Bob posted it. Okay, at word origin from an unused word definition: dry earth, dust. NASB translation: ashes, debris, dirt, dry soil, dust, dusty earth, ground, heap, loose earth, plaster, rubbish, rubble. From BibleHub.com, Hebrew. BibleHub.com/Hebrew/6083.htm. Again, we see same meaning for dust that it is in English.
Okay.
Would you like another source?
Yeah, go ahead. I have these same sources, by the way. And that's not refuting my argument. Okay, again, what you're looking at here are just basic translations from one word to the next. I mean, from one language to the next. That's all you're looking at here. All right? That's why you have some words here.
Okay, and the issue you had earlier was that there's a difference between how words are translated from one language to another, correct?
No, those of you who speak multiple languages, you know that there's some things that you can't say in English that can be said in a different language, and vice versa.
Yeah, and a good example of that is in Japanese, the concept of yugen. There's no English there's no way to translate that in English. I agree.
Not so with dust.
So, not so with dust. With the word afar, dirt. But again, what you're looking at, it to me, seems to be it just giving you a very basic definition of what afar means. That's it. It doesn't go into detail in science like what you did before and tells you what the human is made of. It just simply says dirt.
Okay, and so when this dust is being referenced and it says it means dry earth, is there another type of dry earth that is now being referenced?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that it's just using a very simplistic term to say what we're made of. That's it.
And that's fine. So is there a different chemical composition of that dust than the dust we have now?
I'm trying to tell you, it doesn't go into those type of details. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, so we know.
And it doesn't need to.
And that's fine, because you know what's interesting is that if there was a different composition of what the dust is then and now, we'd have evidence for that. What you were trying to sit here and posit is that there's a different type of dust that they're somehow referencing, but yet there's no evidence for such a thing.
I'm positing that I think you're jumping to conclusions to asserting that there's an error there when it doesn't go. It doesn't give you any specific detail. It just simply a very simplistic term, dust of the earth.
That's fine. And we know what that dust is, do we not?
Right here, because if you don't want to accept that, that's fine. I understand.
I mean, no. Do we know what dust is made of? Yes or no?
A contradiction. I think you can pick up something else.
Do we know what dust is made of?
Again, it's not a legitimate contradiction. I'm just simply
saying. Okay, do we know what dust is made of?
Very simple language to me.
Do we know what dust is made of, Iveco? It's a really easy question. I know you're uncomfortable right now, and it's fine, but do we know what dust is made of?
I love talking to atheists, but we don't need to.
We don't need to? Oh, okay. That's not my question. Do we know what it's made of? What is dust made of, Veckel?
We don't need to understand it in order to understand what the Bible's actually trying to convey.
Okay, so cool. So we know what dust is, and don't we know how to break it down and find out what it's made of?
No, the Bible doesn't prohibit us from wanting to study these things out. However,
I must be speaking Greek.
I don't see a legitimate contradiction. That's
okay, so, and you're still avoiding my question. Do we know what dust is made of?
I already answered this question.
No, you did not. You're avoiding it for like the fifth time.
No, I'm not avoiding it. I said I don't know.
You don't know. Okay, is there anyone on this planet Earth that knows what dust is made of?
Dust of the ground. That's it.
Okay. Do we have someone that could, I don't know, possibly find out what it's made of?
Okay. Well, you have the internet. You could search it for yourself real quick.
We do. Silicon dioxide. And Helena is right. Mm. Okay. He could have picked carbon since plants supposedly came first. Would need carbon for that. I just find it interesting, though. I like harping on these points because it makes Christians really uncomfortable and they have to stray away from the questions.
No, you should. I'm not uncomfortable at all, actually.
You are. That's why you haven't answered the question that I've asked like five times.
You just don't like the answer.
You've done everything but answer.
That's not going to work on me, bro. That's not going to work on me, bro.
Oh, I know. Cognitive dissonance is strong with this one.
None of y'all, okay? Y'all don't have anything to bring to the table that's going to destroy anybody's faith here. But again,
I didn't say I was trying to.
Dust of the ground. That's it. That's all. To me, it's really that simple. I don't need to. The Bible is not claiming to be a science book. It's not used as a science book.
Didn't say it was.
It's giving you a very simplistic idea of where man came from. That's all. It doesn't go into detail. And I'm perfectly fine with that. There's a lot of things about God and that's explained in the Bible that we don't understand. And I'm perfectly fine with some of this in the world.
It's really sad.
Why are we still paying taxes?
Really sad.
You would say that. Yep. Thank you.
Yeah, what the thing Helena said about the carbon being from the plants.
I love that.
Wouldn't that only be if the plant died and decayed in the dirt? You get the carbon from the plants in the dirt? And since there was no death, at that time, then there wouldn't be no carbon from the plants in the dirt.
Oh, Bob.
The dirt could have had bits of... Hold on. The dirt could have had bits of actual plant, bits of roots in it. It just says dirt.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah. That's fair.
It's not a great one, but it does point out that if you would just do a tiny bit, even a little bit of chemistry, so you knew sort of how stuff sticks to carbon and stuff like that, it would be easy to deal with dread on this particular issue, and you wouldn't have to go into Hebrew and stuff like that.
I understand, and guys, I don't want you to get me wrong, because I am not, and you have not heard me in any hangout try to get people away from studying these things out, because as a matter of fact, I always say the complete opposite. The Bible actually commands us and commends when we actually search these things out. So we're not against science. We're not against people searching these things out. My issue is when a person says that there's a contradiction or error in the Bible, I ask them to substantiate it. And so far, I haven't heard anything. All I heard was the Bible says dust on the ground. That's one side. And then the other side says that science says this is what humans are made of. Okay, fine. But to me, that's not a strong contradiction or a strong dichotomy. All we see is the Bible saying dust of the earth. That's it.
When you have to know what dust is made of in order to draw that conclusion?
If you want to know, if you want that detail, sure. But again, the Bible doesn't get it.
Well, how do you know what it's referencing if you don't know what it is?
Oh, I don't know. It just simply says dust of the earth.
So it could be a cow for all you know.
It says dust of the earth.
So how what are you attaching? What is dirt?
What is your understanding of that? When you say dust of the earth, what is your understanding?
It just says dust of the earth.
No, but what is your understanding like?
Okay, I've already answered this question too. Okay, the reason why you guys think I'm avoiding is because you're not listening. I said that I don't know.
Now.
Okay, all I said is the Bible says dust of the earth.
So when you read that, when you read that passage,
hold on a second.
When you read that passage, Beckel,
right now, I need to say this right now. Beckel,
that's it.
Sorry, guys, hold on. Right, really, we need to just stop saying things like that, Beckel. You understand what I'm talking about?
I mean, I'm sorry, man, but I really can't.
Cool.
Really
I know. I do it all the time, Beckel. I'm not trying to accuse you of being like really bad or anything. I'm just saying, let's watch it.
Okay, well, I tell you what, I'll watch it if you watch it. How about that?
I'll try.
Okay, great. We got a deal.
So, Becca, okay, cool. You just said something interesting to me, which was basically, even the point that I brought up is relatively irrelevant to you, right? So, I mean, the fact that, let's suppose there literally was no carbon, right? It still wouldn't matter, because you're making a different point. Which I'm not sure I can, you know, support or go along with.
Well, again, Jesus says we can come to him as a child, Father. That means that we can come to him in the most extremely simplistic faith, and we can establish a relationship with this God, okay? That doesn't mean that that is the only way that you can come to Christ. I mean, you can come to Christ through any various different means. You know, we have extremely, extremely intelligent people who are in the church, who are, you know, philosophers, scientists, and stuff like that. Of course, you probably deny that their status, but the fact of the matter is these people are very, very intelligent, way more apt to have this discussion than I ever will, that I can even dream of. And you'd be better off talking to those guys. But to me, you're talking to a simpleton here. At least I admit it. Maybe you should too, but it says dust of the ground. That's it. As a matter of fact, Peripheral Prophets here, he actually has some study in the area of botany, I think. He may be able to better explain what the Bible says itself, or maybe he comes to a very simplistic conclusion as I do as well. It says dirt. Doesn't go into detail, folks. That's it.
I don't think Helena's question was actually answered, but anyway.
I can't understand it, but
that was you offered her bread.
Again, I don't think, well, hopefully you guys understand my point. Okay, my point is real, really simple.
It's obviously
the earth, could we just silicone, okay? The Bible, the word silicone, is not used.
How do you know that just because...
That's a thing about God.
God couldn't... Hold on, Duckle. People today, human beings, could not comprehend today how God did it, let alone the people that authored the Bible.
I mean, how do you know? How do you know we couldn't comprehend it?
What do you mean? Because you're not God. You're the created, not the creator.
Well, so what? That doesn't mean you don't comprehend it.
There's a supernatural intellectual prowess to understand the supernatural. Right?
Yeah, but by that logic, peripheral, God didn't know either.
Well, if he's God and he's omniscient, he has all knowledge, and you are human and do not have all knowledge and are not omniscient, then you don't know.
He can't tell us. All he can do is make meaningless statements about metaphoric things that possibly could have happened in some possible way.
Or God is omniscient,
wide enough. Or we can pretend that, you know, the primitive people somehow had this idea that an all-powerful deity needed physical dirt to create humans instead of just raw power and magic. I like that idea. We can pretend like that's not inconsistent with reality all day, but at the end of the day... At the end of the day, you're still relying on magic to help prove your point, and piling assertions on top of it doesn't make it valid.
Well, no, Drag, I agree. From a natural... If you're a philosophical naturalist, if you don't believe in anything supernatural and that the universe is eternal, it's always existed, there is no supernatural answer for where it came from, then sure, you're going to struggle to have this idea that there is a supernatural interface taking place at some point, right? Or that God himself... And how do you choose... How do you know what a God chooses to do with how he creates? If he creates a universe, he creates the matter, and then he decides he's going to use the matter as a platform for life. Well, how do you have any say whatsoever in what he chooses to do?
Because if he is, in fact, interfacing with reality, there would be evidence of it, and that's why my entire example...
Well, that's what reality is. That is the evidence, but most people...
What you're trying to do is misunderstand what I'm saying. If, in fact, that there is some type of supernatural force that is digging into this reality and warping things, then there would be evidence to point to it. In this case, if there was an SI on those chemical bonds instead of a C, that would, in fact, back your claim. So I'm not at any point saying that this cannot be proven or that, you know, this is impossible. I am saying that reality goes against your claim.
I think you're applying a standard that doesn't necessarily follow. You're saying it would have to be silicone-based. Why?
Is he digging into reality, the laws, the natural laws of this earth?
Well, who says that he has to do anything, though? You're saying that he has to create life and make it silicone-based because silicone is abundant, but how does that follow? I don't understand why. Why do you make the choice and not God in that case?
I'm not saying I made the choice. I'm saying that if he has to work within the confines of this reality in order to do things, then he has to use what's available, which is completely
fine. That's what he did.
And if he did indeed use something that's available, that it wouldn't make sense for him to pull something that was less abundant, way less abundant, from something that's way more abundant. It doesn't logically follow for a deity to do that, especially if he knows
people... According to standards, you're not a deity. You don't have the standard of deity to judge him by.
Here's the fun part. If he honestly wanted and knew that people were going to go in and research this stuff, that's a tidbit he could have purposely put in there in order to verify what's being said, because he knew people during that time did not know chemistry, but he knew people later on would eventually learn it and find and connect these dots, which would lead them to faith.
Right, so you don't have a standard to judge by which
I have a, yes,
choose.
I choose.
Well, no, you don't. You're not a God. So if God says, I'm going to choose to make life carbon-based, you don't really have an argument to the contrary, other than, well, I think maybe this is what God should have done, but you're not a God. He is.
Stating that I don't have a basis.
I didn't say you didn't have a basis. You have an opinion based on you're looking at evidence. You see this abundance of silicone. And sure, maybe if you were a God, that's what you would have done. But God chose something differently. And you don't really have a leg to stand on to say how he should have. according to the biblical narrative, how he should have done things, right? How do you know? You don't. He's a god or not. So there's a problem.
Actually, we do have something. We have something from God himself called reason.
So right? For some reason, humans cannot derive their basis out of just the facts of what is. There has to be another category created for this deity that circumvents logic that's now being posited. And that really flies in the face of anything that a Christian would say that would make logical sense to prove that there is a deity. I mean, you can't circumvent logic to praise God and then try to...
God is the arbiter of logic.
And you can say that all day, but when he flies in the face of what would be logical, then he's not.
Well, if you're defining what is logical and you're in error, then you're falsely assigning a logical fallacy of some sort to God, saying, well, God should have done it this way, but God chose a different way, therefore God is wrong. Well, wait a minute. If God chose to do it that way and he's omniscient, then he had a purpose for it or a reason for it, and you don't have a standard to judge against that.
If I'm in error, is there evidence that you could put forth to show that I am in error, since what I'm saying actually aligns with reality?
Are you omniscient?
Do you have to be? Do you have evidence to show that one has to be in order to be relevant and true?
Well, I'm not saying that. In all
yes, you are. You are exactly saying that I need.
Because
I
God
need.
Is. You
how
aren't.
How does omniscience add veracity to my statement?
Well, it doesn't. You don't.
Thank you. That's my point. No, it doesn't. Exactly. How does omniscience add to the veracity of a statement?
Well, okay. If somebody was omniscient, any statement they purport to say is going to be by definition true because they have all knowledge, whereas you don't. So if you don't have omniscience,
doesn't follow. No, he has to be also truthful and, you know, not be a, you know, devil.
Right, but somebody who has all knowledge is capable of answering all questions to give an answer.
He's telling the truth if he chooses to tell you the truth.
Having the ability to tell the truth, it does not change whether you have all knowledge or some knowledge.
Right, we're not talking about a God who's lying. We're talking about a God who has all knowledge.
I'm not talking about God. I'm talking about me.
Humans who have very limited knowledge. I don't even think it's adequate to say that the knowledge possessed by, say, a flea compared to humans is even comprehensible in regards to how much more knowledge God actually has than we do. I mean, we're looking at the universe from the ground up. God's got it all already. We're trying to figure it out from the bottom up, you know? And we're trying to create the standard by which to judge a God and how he decides to do things as if he's somehow wrong because we have a better idea. Well, that doesn't really follow. That's like the guy at the lowest level of the chain of command telling the captain what he thinks he should do. Well, the captain has the bigger picture. You don't. You're at the bottom.
How does... Go ahead, Max.
Oh, just to add my two cents in here. A nice analogy might be, consider this. Imagine if you have Tolkien's huge Lord of the Rings series, and from out of that you just ripped one page, and you just read it without any context to the rest of the book. Now, in terms of judging and critiquing the author, you might have some interesting and maybe even rationally considered such... feedback coming from just the analysis of one page, but you'd have to admit, considering that you're missing huge segments of the book and the plot, maybe your analysis, while reasonable considering what you do know, might not be well informed considering all the stuff you don't know. Maybe that's the best way to phrase the analogy to the best of my ability.
Sure, and then for that you would need evidence that the book itself existed.
Right.
Token is fiction. Maybe we can pick a non-fiction book?
the point of tokens, well, if the page is ripped from the book, the book itself does exist. But I think you raised a point such that let's look at some kind of design flaw. Why does God decide to design our body such that both the waist and the sexual organ are considered one and the same? That seems like a design flaw. Why does such a God decide to create humans in this way as opposed to this much better way? And considering just the body taken alone in itself in isolation from the rest of the universe and creation, I could totally see why that criticism comes up. But considering that a human being lives as a character, or humans live as characters described partially, perhaps there is some kind of more cosmological reason, or more emergent reason, such that they have the limbs that they do and the design that they do. They have to participate as actors within history, and maybe their biology partakes in some way. For example, why do people's feet get tired? Well, it just so happens that they do. That they do, considering the weight that's put on them, and how they might be weaker by comparison. That seems like a design flaw, but perhaps it led Rosa Parks at one point in history to consider, man, I'm tired, I might as well just sit in front of the bus. Like, that greater thing came out of it. So now I'm not saying that that's what actually happened, but just concocting this relationship between something that might seem problematic in itself, but when taken into the greater context of creation as a whole, might seem to make a lot more sense. And considering God has the full view of that, we might not be in a position to judge up until the point where we can see it from a perspective similar to his.
Sure, I could sit and assert also that any proposition put forth by anyone else is erroneous because they also do not contain the information from a standard that I myself has set for them. So if I have a professor that says, well, you know what, X, Y equals Z, my retort to him would be that since you did not go throughout the entire alphabet and the alphabet that you have yet to discover, you cannot therefore draw such a conclusion. The issue here is that I would have to then prove that there is an extended alphabet in order that would comply with the context of whatever it is that we're talking about. I mean, I could literally posit any criteria that I want in order to downplay the evidence that is already presented when no one can actually prove that such
of our makeup. It's probably not as much obviously as calcium, but
so wait, so Perif, when it says dust of the earth, how do you take that? How do you accept that?
Bro? I just take it very simply. It means that we're created from the matter that the planet is made out of, quite simply. I don't try to break it down into like certain chemical elements and whatever. Right. I don't try to presume how God what supernatural process God used to create different, you know, interactions with different mineral nutrients and chemicals and all that stuff. I don't even think about that kind of stuff.
Yeah, me too. That's all I was pointing out. I mean, I'm not. And again, guys, don't get us wrong. We're not saying that the Bible prohibits people from searching these things out. Again, I would argue that the Bible says the complete opposite. It wants us to search these things out. So in the end, we end up glorifying God even more. But the fact of the matter is, when we're arguing about the simplistic term "dust of the earth," dust of the ground, whatever. That's all it says, folks. That's it. It doesn't go into detail. A lot of atheists ask, well, if God created the earth or God created the universe, how did he do it? It doesn't say how. It just says that he did. It doesn't give you any specific details of what compound he used. It just says that he spoke it.
Well, maybe this may not be the issue for some. I'm naturally inquisitive, naturally. Taking people's word for it, that's really not good enough for me in most cases. So when there is a claim and I'm within the realm of possibility for me to verify it, I want to check it out. In this case, it seems inconsistent with the claim and reality. And just to kind of give you illustration, this is a goat protein, but you see how you see all these C's in here? These C's are holding everything together. There'll be an SI instead of that C. That's really what I'm talking about.
Okay, what's this we're looking at? Dust or
no? This is a goat. This is a protein. This is a goat protein, actually. Oh. But this is a chain, and so this chain is being held together by these C's. And these C's represent carbon. My issue is that these C's should be SI, because SI is found in dust of the earth.
Yeah, but that's a protein. What about, like, are you looking into, like, the bone structure? I mean, is there any silicon in the bone structure at all? I mean,
That's actually a good question.
The anatomy of humans is not something I'm too familiar with. I mean, but yeah, I wouldn't expect to find much silicon in a protein. But now in maybe bone structures, I would think that I don't know, maybe some kind of other organs or something. I don't know.
Yeah, and that was the other thing, too. Maybe when it was written, when it said the term dust of the earth was used, maybe it's just using that one word, afar, in a general sense, referring to all of the elements. I think, Griff, you already said that. It could be just referring to all of the elements rather than just one particular element. I don't know. But it just simply says dust of the earth.
Yeah, I mean, well, and that's fine. I mean, we can say that, you know, dust meant something else if that's actually in the text, it's somewhere. But from what it seems like, you wanted to go to the Hebrew translation, and we found two different versions that said it literally meant dirt from the ground. And unless there is another place that is absent of carbon being there, then I'm not seeing how you're avoiding acknowledging that there may be an issue here with this.
Well, anybody who studies Hebrew, and again, I don't speak Hebrew, I don't read or write it. However, I have studied the concordance long enough and other sources to know that the Hebrew language is just as homonymic as the English and the Greek. So again, it's okay for them to use the word afar in different forms, in different manners. And that, so again, the word afar to mean a generalized combination of something. You know, just simply saying, well, God used this and this and this, put that with there, and then he used this, this, and this, and put that with there. Why not just use a generalized term to say, let's call it dust. You know, it's still saying the same thing. There's no contradiction. It's just not going as strong.
I didn't say it was a contradiction again, but the issue here, if you go back to the website, there's actually all the instances of afar. Dr. Joel M. Hoffman goes through and eliminates possibilities each time the word afar occurs in the Bible. And so he even goes to Genesis 2:7. Right. And he says, so Genesis 2:7 should read, the Lord God formed man from the dirt of the ground. I mean,
I'll look at that source and I'll compared it to some of the sources that I have, and I'm pretty sure they may end up doing the same thing. But I don't have a problem with the generalized term dirt being used.
That's fine with me too, because I mean, for body, me, dirt. Go ahead.
What happens to the body when it decays? I mean, does it turn into mush? Does it look like something like a rotten apple, or does it turn into something that looks like dust?
I can't find what the actual chemical makeup of bones are, other than silicon is, it's necessary for our bone structure. So
it's
actually a derivative. It's not actual silicone, right? It's some derivative. The silicone won't easily make different bonds. It's not pliable. Does that make sense? So there is something like it, but it's just a derivative. It's not actual silicon.
Silicon is one of the most abundant elements in the universe, and is fundamental to the basic bone and skeletal structure of each and every one of us. I'm trying to find something on this. I'm not really sure. Again, I'd have to study so much stuff to really put together cohesive.
I looked it up on one chart, and it says silicone makes up less than 1% of the human body. Less than 1%.
I mean, yeah, I never said it wasn't in there. It's just, as far as our chemical bonds are concerned, to me, we should be silicone-based. And actually, it's funny, I was listening to a lecture on astrobiology and what kind of life forms that we should expect to find in other planets. And one of the possibilities was a silicone-based organism, just because of how many chemical bonds it can form, that's close to the number that carbon can.
That's so funny. That's one of the daydreams I have. Like I think, you know, everyone always talks about carbon-based life, but I would imagine there would be a silicone-based life. So it's really cool to hear that other people are saying that.
Well, guys, I'm gonna ask a real simple question. Okay, real simple, because that's all that I can do in this discussion. Is what happens to the body after it dies?
So it's an apple. It's like a rotten apple. Then it's like dust.
Yes. If you leave a human body,
do
we turn into a rotten apple or do we turn into dust? Well, we go through a rotten apple stage and then.
Right. When you excavate and you see skeletons, what happened to the flesh? Where's the flesh? Why is it just a bone?
It biodegrades.
Well, rotten apple. It was rotten apple, and then it interacted with the stuff that was touching it, and animals came and stuff like that.
Put a body out in the desert and leave it there long enough without it being covered, and it'll eventually just disintegrate.
Yeah, exactly. Disintegrate, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it'll look like a dust-like material of some sort, right? I mean, the skin doesn't just fall off a body and go wobble somewhere else. No, it actually disintegrates.
Yes, so, but it goes through a rotten apple stage. I mean, you're not saying it doesn't.
Well, it doesn't actually.
But what I'm saying, ultimately, why could not the author who put the term dust of the earth, why couldn't he not look at a decomposed body after that process and say, oh, okay, this is what we're made of, and use that?
Yeah, he probably did. I mean, for Drag is interested more in the mechanics of it and how could it have been possible and that kind of thing. For me, as an atheist, it's like a bullhorn. That this is a person with less knowledge than us, or people with less knowledge than us, doing their best to make scientific sense out of things. So then it makes me question divinity, right? That's not divinely inspired. That mistake can't be divinely inspired. It's just some people doing their best.
I mean, that's what it seems like.
I guess we're just at an impasse because I don't see a mistake. I think that if properly reduced, the human body would essentially return to the dust of the earth, if that's how you wanted to say it. I think you could say that the human body is made of all of the elements that the earth contains, obviously, or else we wouldn't be producing children. So, you know, what those proportions are, if you're concerned with that and that's the defeater for you personally, hey, I guess we're at an impasse.
Actually, I'm glad that Dragon has this inquiry because, again, you know, like I always say, I love talking to atheists because it actually poses a challenge to the faith, and it gets people who are professing to be of Christ to really think about why they believe what they believe. Are you believing it because your mama made you go to church, or are you believing it because you have strong faith in what this book says?
Or people are just scared.
And I commend you guys for bringing up these objections and these questions. So I would not encourage you to stop doing it. I actually encourage you to keep doing it. But I would also encourage you to repent and turn to Christ and get to know Him and get to know your God better.
Okay. When you do that, I'm going to tell you right now, that's really disrespectful.
How is it disrespectful?
Okay. For one thing.
Mark on your face. That's why.
Okay. So when you go, you need to repent. You need to turn. I don't like this idea of self-depreciation. I really, that gets on my last nerve. I'm just throwing it out there. I understand you feel that everyone's a sinner and we need to praise this deity in order for us to be worth something, but to me, that's self-depreciation. I'm just throwing it out there.
Well, the Bible says that you would have that attitude. So,
and I honestly don't. The Bible can't even get basic chemistry right, so it really doesn't matter that much to me.
Well, the Bible's not making an assertion about chemistry. hold on. What I wanted to say was that the
that's an error right there.
The Bible says God created the heavens and the earth, but it doesn't say what the supernatural interface with the temporal was in order to create the heavens and the earth. Does that make it not true? Absolutely not. It just means that it doesn't describe what only a God would know in order to do that, you know, have this process take place. How could we understand things from God's perspective? We're not God.
Why doesn't it describe that? It doesn't describe that because the people at the time that they wrote it didn't know. That's why.
In the English text, it's not used in the Hebrew.
Wasn't even invented.
I don't see a problem. I don't see a problem. Right.
What was Helena's question again? Because if that wasn't answered, I think I'd really like to go to that point.
Helena asked him what his understanding
was. I was getting tired. I was like, you know, jumping up and down because Drag, and he said, he admits, is not the right word, but, you know, agrees that his argument about silicone, because silicone is the most diverse element in soil, right? So, that God should have, if we were creatures based in silicone, because things stick to silicone almost as well as carbon, then the Bible would be more in line with what we know. And I was jumping up and down because I was like, that's pretty easily diffused, because doesn't the Bible say that plants came first? And if plants came first, boom, you have carbon, so God could just pick carbon. But what was interesting was that Ben Veckel was making a point that, you know, even if my argument was flawed and bad, or even if there was absolutely no carbon anywhere, so that Drag's comment was absolutely 100% irrefutable, it wouldn't make any difference to Veckel. That is what's interesting to me.
Oh, yeah.
It would matter to me because if we see something completely contrary, what's being said here. But again, how do we know? Let's first of all understand what a contradiction is, or a dichotomy is. You have something, one says this, another one says that. Okay. It'd be one thing if the Bible says that we're all made of oranges, and when we're not. Or if we're all made of a piece of metal or a car or something like that, when science says the complete opposite. But this example of the dust of the earth is that's not a legitimate contradiction. All Dragnut and everybody else is doing is looking at the ingredients of that make up the human body, and then comparing that to the simple term dust of the earth.
I mean, if I could just say real quick, he never did claim that there was a contradiction. He was saying that there's an error, not a contradiction, just that there's an error.
But it sounds like he's pointing out a contradiction. Though he says it's
I did not. I would have used that word if I wanted to say that. I purposely avoided the word contradiction.
Oh, okay. Well, but to me, it sounds like a contradiction because you're saying the Bible says one thing while science says another. Hmm? So there's a contradiction, not within itself, but between the Bible and science, according to you.
Yeah, no, there's a difference between a contradiction and a mistake, right? He was just saying that it's, I mean, to me, the way I read it, and I know he never did imply this, but I added this part, was that if there's a mistake, so it's people that wrote it, people who didn't know anything about chemistry at the time, right? So it's just people that wrote it, and that's pretty obvious, because the dust would be hardly any carbon, and you'd have to sort of point out that there could be some carbon, blah, blah, blah. So, but he wasn't saying that there was a specific contradiction, just that, in fact, here's an example where it's pretty clear that there's a mistake going on.
Okay, but be that as it may, even if it wasn't a legitimate mistake, how is something like that, or why even bring something like that up in a discussion, in an attempt to debunk the Bible? I mean, I would point you to other areas. I can point out to allegedly better contradictions than, or better errors.
Again, it's not a contradiction, but go ahead.
I said, okay, errors. Okay.
So he brought that up probably because it was the first thing.
Errors than the one that was pointed out. That's what I'm saying.
Would you bring it up because you find the ones that are less indefensible, or that you personally don't have a background in chemistry?
Well, both actually.
So since I do, I would like to start from the beginning and go toward the end, and I do know a little bit about chemistry.
That's cool.
You know, why not? Let's start at the. Let's start the claim. The beginning when God spoke things into existence, and let's just go from there.
Okay. Well, I understand that. That's cool. It's just that to me, when the Bible uses a simple term like dust of the earth. To me, that seems rather ambiguous. I think it could be taken a lot of places from that point on, especially when you guys claim that they didn't study chemistry back then. Okay, I'll grant you that. If that's the case, why is it wrong for them to use such simplistic terms to say this is what humans were made of?
Because it would seem to be an error with what we know in science. It cannot be. If it would be the case that it could be substantiated. We could actually prove that, yes, we are created from the dust of the earth, which I'm not sure how it's ambiguous, but would be granules or particulates, I think they're called, that are from the earth, from the ground, that are in the air sometimes. So we could have been silicone-based, and that would actually substantiate that particular claim.
Yeah, but we were – okay. There would be processes that God would have had to have employed. He would have had to take material, right, and actually, you know, create processes during that, utilizing that material to form a human, right? He didn't literally, like, take a piece of phosphorus and a piece of calcium and, like, stick them together and form this human out of, like, you know, particles. It wasn't like that. There was obviously a deeper process involved, right? So what we're saying is that God used the matter that he created the earth from to create humans, which is how humans are created, right? Whenever you procreate, for example, the food that your wife eats to create that baby either comes from animals who eat the plant matter, or she eats the plant matter directly. Plants synthesize nutrients from the ground and pull them into their cells. Basically, they're made out of the dirt. They're using all of the chemical elements that we're eating and consuming. So it's a different process for how we build children in the womb of a woman, whereas God would have bypassed that, just used the elements available straight up. I don't know if that makes any sense, but it sounds like I don't know what's the argument, like, that there's not a scientific explanation for how God did it. Well, that's kind of obvious.
It sounds almost peripheral, and I'm going to let you fix me on this, but it sounds kind of like you're saying, hold on, God is magic, and you're forgetting the magic part.
I'm not saying God is magic. I mean, what's your definition? I think magic or parlor tricks or something like that.
Supernatural.
Okay, supernatural, yes. I would be saying God is, in fact, supernatural, and employed a technique native only to himself, obviously, to create the first human life from the matter of the earth and what he had already created prior to that, because we are physical. I mean, if you extrapolate all of the water, all of the gases from our flesh, mm-hmm. you're left with mineral nutrients, are you not?
I'm sorry, I didn't listen to you because I was waiting to say something. Say that again.
Okay, if you take all of the water out of our bodies, right? Take it all out.
Yeah.
What are you left with? You're left with what? Calcium.
Carbon, phosphorus, nitrogen, carbon, stuff like
right,
that.
All of these different minerals, right?
Right, so, the stuff that sticks to carbon, yeah.
Okay, so that's just matter. That's all that is. It's not supernatural. It's what you find on planet Earth anyways. So I think that's what we're talking about. Now the actual processes, because like Drag, I think Drag said there would be chemical processes that would take place, obviously. So I don't really know how that part happened, because that's something that God would have had to, he would understand that. I don't understand how he did that.
Okay, I mean, if we're going to...
We understand it through, you know, how a child is formed in the womb and how mineral nutrients are consumed and collated and things like that, so...
We can posit the supernatural, that's fine. The issue here is that there is a connection between the two parts that supposedly created Adam was one supernatural with the breath, and then the material from the dust that actually formed a physical being of a human. And so my issue is that since the earth, the crust of it, is 90% silica, which is silicon dioxide, it would seem more likely that we would be silicone-based, as far as not our composition, but the chemical bonds that make up, like, our epithelial tissue, for example. That makes sense.
Okay. I don't really...
You don't well,
I'm not really sure what you're talking about.
Okay, so if you know we're made... I'll break it. Let's see. You know, we have protein in our body, and that protein makes up different organs, tissues, and whatnot, correct? Like protein and carbohydrates?
Yes.
Okay. They are formed from complex chemical chains. These chains are bound together by the element of carbon. Now, if we were made physically from the dust from the earth, we would instead have silicone as this base for these chains instead of that carbon. That is the issue that I'm bringing up here.
Okay. So you think that we should if the Bible's true, we should be silicon-based, basically, is what you're saying.
Yeah, that's exactly basically. It.
Yes.
That's
okay.
Yes. If the Bible's true, we would be silicone-based, because almost everything in dirt is silicone, right? So I think that's what he's saying.
I mean, if I'm not mistaken, what is it? Is it SiO2 is the chemical, or is the, for silicone, is that?
Yeah, silicone dioxide, yes.
SiO2, I think, off the top of my head.
SiO2, yes.
Silicone, okay.
I think that's one of the compounds that we do use. I mean, it's part of our makeup. Same with plants. I mean, so I don't know, you know, to what degree SI is part of our makeup. Somebody who's probably a little more studied in that would have to tell me. But I mean, I do know it's. I'm sure it has to be a component.